was to do?
That is the plan.
Dreams have gone astray. When I'm stranded in the valley and I'm tired and all alone, it seems like I've lost my way.
Hearts are yearning for you.
when we see you, we find strength to face the day. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away. They're washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna. You are the God who saves us. Worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna. Come on, you way among us. Welcome you here, Lord
be seated. Good morning. How's everybody doing this morning? All right, before we get started, if you happen to find a phone, it's mine. It's So just go from there. All right. Good morning. Welcome to Believers Fellowship. So glad that you could make it this morning. And praise God, his grace is enough. Amen. Amen. It is great to see you in the house of the Lord this morning. If you are new to our church or you have a prayer request, please, there are welcome cards in the seat back in front of you. I would ask that you use those cards to either introduce yourself to us or to put a prayer request on there. Drop it in the offering receptacle at the end of the service. We would love the opportunity to meet you, greet you, and get in contact with you. And just if you have any prayer needs, to definitely pray with you and for you. Amen. Amen. Typically at this time, this would be the time where we would gather around and welcome everybody that's here or just, you know, talk to people that we hadn't seen the past week. But since we can't do that, look to your left, look to your right, look to your front, look to your back, and just wave at people that are here. It's good to see the Cools here this morning. Thank y'all for being here. Even though I'm preaching, thank y'all for coming. Appreciate it. Somebody didn't give you the heads up. So, and over there, there's Liz back there as well. Good to see you this morning. Today's reading is going to be out of Colossians 1, 15 through 23. Colossians 1, 15 through 23. So let's stand as we honor the Lord with the reading of his word. And this is God's word. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by him all things were created, both in the heavens and on earth, visible and invisible, with thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities. All things have been created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in all, and in him all things hold together. Amen. Don't we need that more than ever right now? He is also head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, so that he himself will come to have first place in everything. For it was the Father's good pleasure for all the fullness to dwell in him, and through him to reconcile all things to himself, having made peace through the blood of his cross. Through him, I say, whether things on earth or things in heaven, and although you were formerly alienated and hostile in mind, engaged in evil deeds, yet he has now reconciled you in his fleshly body through death, in order to present you before him holy and blameless and beyond reproach. If indeed you continue in the faith, firmly established and steadfast, and not moved away from the hope of the gospel that you have heard, which was proclaimed in all creation under heaven, and of which I, Paul, was made a minister. And that's God's word. Let's pray. Father, we do thank you for your grace, Father. Father, we thank you for your power of reconciliation, Father. Father, my heart is heavy this morning, Father. Just from those that are hurting, Father. Father, I pray for Eddie Ferguson, Father. I pray for his family, Father. Father, I pray that you heal him, Father, either physically here on earth or spiritually in eternity in heaven, Father. Father, I pray for the Soria family, Father. I pray for Jerry, Father, this morning, Father. He's struggling with the reality, Father, that he doesn't know how much longer he has, Father. But praise God, he has peace knowing that he knows you, Father. And Father, I'm sure I'm forgetting somebody, but you know, Father, and those that are here right now, Father, let them lift up their loved ones, Father. Father, we thank you for all that you do. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Please remain standing.
Sweet the sound that saved. Then
of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sing my soul, my Savior God, to thee.
Let's praise the band and praise God. Amen. Amen for everything that they do. Thank y'all so much for this past year. It's been a struggle, I know, from have service to not having service to having service again. And y'all are definitely a blessing. So thank you. Thank you to each and every one of y'all. As they continue, every week they continue to get our hearts right, ready for God. Amen. Amen. So this morning we're going to be out of Colossians, like I said, and the title is The Gift of Peace. To know Jesus, or to know Jesus is to know peace. You know, this year has been a difficult year for a lot of people. You know, of course, the obvious, right? COVID, lockdown, shutdown, unrest, conflict, loss of jobs, loss of businesses, loss of livelihoods, loss of homes, loss of loved ones. I mean, the list can go on and on and on of all the things that have happened this year. And if anything, in that list, where do you find peace, right? When will I have it? Where do I find it? Some of it, I mean, if you're like me, I can't even find peace in my head sometimes when I start thinking about all the things that have happened this year. It's just, you know, I get lost in my thoughts and I just start thinking like, wow, all this is happening and where's peace? But this morning, I want to talk about, and we'll discover how we were given the gift of peace over 2,000 years ago. This gift of peace came during a time of both external conflict and internal conflict. This gift was promised by the angels who spoke to the shepherds in the field that night Jesus was born. If you look at Luke 2, 13 through 14, it says, and suddenly there appeared to the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among men with whom he is well pleased. Now, the gift of peace arrived during a time when the world was not at peace. Jews were under persecution, right? Herod was in control, and he reigned in Judea, and the Jews hadn't heard from God in over 400 years when Malachi last spoke to them. So at no point, you know, there was conflict going on. There was struggle going on. So there was no peace. But if we take a look at this passage a little closer, if you look at that last line on there, it says, with whom he is well pleased. You see, not everybody receives this gift of peace. Not everybody gets to experience the peace that the angels talked about in this verse. So what is this peace that the angels described? It's Jesus. He is our peace. Isaiah 9:6 says, his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Eternal Father. And what? Prince of Peace. So the question this morning is, why do I need to know Jesus if I want to know peace? It's simple, really. He is our peace. So if we open our Bibles back up into Colossians. So if you could open your Bible to Colossians 1, chapter 1, verses 15 through 23. And I know we read this last week, but I really want to hit a point here this morning. And so if you open your Bible to that, let me give you some background. And so Paul's writing the church in Colossae. And during this time, there was false teachers within the church. And they were saying that there's no way Jesus was 100% man and 100% God. God is all 100% good and perfect, and man is not. And so they said there has to be multiple layers between God and man. And so God and Jesus are not one. They also said that, you know, there's other ways, right? They talked about how, you know, Jesus isn't the only way. There's more ways ahead. If you know the secret, you know, all the things we heard 2,000 years ago, we're still hearing them today. It's the word of faith movement or cult. It's the secret. I have this new revelation that I want to share with you. If you just send me 4 payments of $49.95. Amen. It's the same thing we're dealing with now is the same thing they dealt with then 2,000 years ago. So there was definitely the internal struggle. And so Paul is writing the church in Colossae, letting them know, no, there's only one way. There's only one way to get to heaven. There's only one person who is 100% man, 100% God. And his name is Jesus. And so why do I need to know Jesus if I want to know peace? Because without Jesus, we're at war with God. Jesus is the only way we can be reconciled to God. So those are the two points we're going to be going over today. So without Jesus, we are at war with God. In verse 21, Paul describes the condition of every person ever born. And although you were formerly alienated and hostile in mind, engaged in evil deeds. We were alienated. We were separated. That word alienate is defined as to estrange, to withdraw, to make different, or to averse. That means to be in opposition to. Where love and or friendship before existed. We use the word alien to refer to strangers or outsiders. We were apart from God. We were apart from the grace of God. All of us were estranged, and we were enemies. Think about that. We were enemies to God. We were not aligned. We were not in a relationship with him. See, we were not just alienated. The Bible goes a step further. It says that we were actively hostile towards God. Not just hostile, actively hostile. Our minds were at war with God. Romans 8:7 says the mind of sinful man is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law, nor can it do so. Our behavior was evil. That word evil translates to worthless. Everything that we did, everything who we were, everything that we stood for before Christ was worthless. Even if you tried to do something good, even if you tried to do something that was pleasing to God. Because you did not have a relationship with God, God saw it as worthless. God saw it as evil because there was no relationship. So for those of us who have accepted Jesus as our Lord and Savior, we were once alienated from God and we were hostile towards him. You think about your relationships that you have now. And yeah, you have falling outs, right? But there's always a reconciliation. There's always a forgiveness. Well, before Christ, there was no reconciliation. There was no forgiveness. It was just hostility. It was just worthless and evil what you were doing. See, we were engaged in evil deeds. If you have not repented from your sins and you have not accepted Jesus as your Savior, you are currently, as you are sitting in this church right now or at home, you are in opposition to God. You are alienated from your Savior. See, the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile towards God because you cannot submit to God's law. Now, lost, anybody ever seen, like, we did it in Lyft years ago. It was the Way of the Master, right? Y'all remember the Way of the Master? You had Ray Comfort and Kirk Cameron, and they would go do some street witnessing, and they would talk about, you know, hey, if God was to ask you, you know, if you were to die today and God asked you, you know, why should I let you into my heaven? What was the number one answer everybody always gave? Well, I'm a good person, right? I'm a good person. Well, that, and I say it all the time, and to say it now, I know I'm beating a dead horse, but I'm going to beat it anyway. Good is subjective. Amen? Good to us is not good to him. There's only one good, and who is that? Jesus. And so we can't be good people because we don't have Jesus. Even if we were, we'd still be filthy rags. But you, my point I'm saying is that a good person doesn't get you into heaven. There are plenty of good people in hell because they did not have a relationship with Jesus. But let me get back to the Way of the Master. So, you know, they would take up through the Ten Commandments, right? Well, have you ever told a lie? Yes. Well, then you're a liar. Have you ever stole anything? Yes. Well, then some people would say, well, then you're a stealer. No, you're a thief, right? So God says, you got to be perfect, so you can't break any of the Ten Commandments. So to lie, to steal, to do those things is what? To break the Ten Commandments, so you're no longer good. See, people try to justify. We always try to justify our actions. Well, I love people. I do good things most of the time. We cannot justify ourselves before God. To do that makes us on the same plane, at level as God. To say that we can justify ourselves before God is to make us God. And there are some teachers, preachers, and pastors that say, you're your own God. And that's a lie out of hell. You are not. See, to not accept Jesus, and some people say, well, you know, I'm a good person. Just because I had accepted Jesus doesn't mean that I'm a bad person. Here's some truth for you. To not accept Jesus is to reject Jesus. By not accepting him, you are actively rejecting him. The fact is that if you've rejected, you have rejected Jesus because you want to live the way you want to live. You think you've deposited enough good deeds that I could do this one thing. No, you haven't. No, you haven't. To be in opposition means to be in total war with God. If we turn to Isaiah 64:6, it says, for all of us have become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous deeds are like a filthy garment. There is nothing good about us. Sophia likes to remind me, you know, that verse, that we are like filthy rags, and she was doing a Bible study, and you know what filthy rags are, right? You think dirt, you know, something, for those guys, people that are in the garage or cleaning the house, dirt, no, that's dirty. No, no, no. Filthy rags were the rags that the lepers wore, the pus-filled rags. That's the filthy rags that the scripture talks about who we are. We are like filthy rags without Jesus. See, there's only two type of people in this world. There's only two kinds of people. Those who know Jesus and have peace with God, and those who don't know Jesus and are therefore still at war with God. That's the only two type of people you have in the world. You could have rich, you could have poor, you could have tall, you could have short. Those are all descriptions. There's only two type of people. Those that know Jesus, those that don't know Jesus. And for those of us that know Jesus, it's only because of one decision that we're not the other. Yeah, we lived our life in the Christian way and the way we should be doing, but it comes down to one decision. It's that one decision that meant eternity, that we accepted Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior. We ask for forgiveness of our sins. That's the only difference between us and a lost person. So what that means is that every single person ever born needs the gift of peace that only comes from Jesus. Amen? The second point is Jesus is the only way we can be reconciled to God. Reconcile, that's an interesting word. You know, we can reconcile our marriage, we can reconcile our friendship. But there's only one person that can reconcile us before God, and that's Jesus. That word reconcile, this comes from the Greek root word, means alosso, which is alosso. And alosso means to change or exchange. To change or exchange. You know, we did a lot of exchanging. Many of y'all probably did that yesterday, amen? After Christmas, you exchange gifts or, you know, you change sizes or whatever it is. But what God did is he changed us. When he sent his son down 2,000 years ago, and what Jesus did on the cross, he reconciled us. He changed us. He gave us the opportunity to be reconciled before God because we were sinners, born sinners. But when we accepted him, we became justified before God. And so we are new. We are changed. We exchanged our sin nature for our new natures, which is in Christ. Amen? Amen. It conveys this idea to change or exchange. It conveys the idea of being reconciled fully and completely. See, Jesus died on this cross and he paid the sin because he loved us so much. Now, some might argue, because some always argue, right? There's always the argument. Well, if God loves me so much, I should be able to do what I want to do. Well, what did Paul tell the Romans? May it never be. Amen? May it never be. Some of y'all might think, some people might think, well, yeah, but... you know, it's grace. I'm under grace. God's got me. I'm all right. Nothing's going to happen. That's fool's gold, brothers and sisters. It's fool's gold. You see, when we accepted Jesus as the Lord and Savior, we were no longer slaves to sin. So why continue to do it? Why continue to be a slave to sin when we have freedom in Jesus? We have victory in Jesus from sin. So why do we continue to sin? Because it's our nature. That's why we have to be in God's word. That's why we got to be in church. That's why we got to fellowship with believers. And so it doesn't get stale to us. God's word should never get stale, and we should never stop learning God's word. Amen? 1 Peter 2:24 says, he himself bore our sins in his body on the cross so that we might die to sins and live for righteousness, for by his wounds you were healed. Because of what Jesus did on the cross, he is both the sacrifice and the justifier, so that our sins can be forgiven and we can be declared righteous before a holy judge. That's the only way. That's the only way is through Jesus. Now, here are the results of the reconciliation. Because of what Jesus did on the cross, because we are now reconciled before God, these are the benefits of reconciliation. First is, we're justified in his sight. We are set apart. We are declared holy by God. We can't do that on our own. There's doesn't matter how much works you do, how much money you give, how much time you spend in the church, it doesn't matter. That does not justify you. There's only one that justifies you, and that's Jesus. The second thing is we presented without blemish. Now, that comes from the Old Testament, right? When they would go before the temple, they would have to have a sacrifice that was unblemished, right? We had that unblemished sacrifice, who was Jesus. And now we are without blemish. This word is applied to the temple, again, to the temple sacrifices. When God looks at us, he sees no blemishes. And praise God for that. Because I don't know about you, and I'm not going to open up my dirty closet, but boy, there were a lot of blemishes. Y'all act like y'all didn't have any. Man, praise God just for that alone. The third thing is we are free from accusation. This is a legal term, which means that we are not to be called in. There is no charge of condemnation or sentence of eternal death can ever be brought against believers. My eternity is sealed by the blood of Jesus. I know where I'm going. For those that don't, because you don't have a relationship. Romans 8, 33 through 34 says, who is he that condemns? Christ Jesus, who died. More than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. See, Paul's emphasis on holy standing before God is a direct attack on what the false teachers were preaching at the time. The false teachers were saying, no, there's more than one way to get to the heaven. There's more than one Jesus. There's got to be more than one God. They promised this kind of perfection for those who had secret and mystical knowledge. There is no secret out there. There's no new revelation. Everything that we need to know and everything that needs to be known is right here. False teachers then and now take the focus off of Jesus and put it on man. People want to make us even or at a level playing field with Jesus. And no. What did Jesus tell Peter, get behind me, Satan? Because that's what it is. It's blasphemy. We are not our own God. We cannot save ourselves. It's only through Jesus. And to minimize Jesus is to be actively hostile towards God. What Paul is saying here is you already have a perfect standing in Christ for those that know him. You are holy in his sight. You are without blemish and free from accusation. Why do you need to look anywhere else? People leave the church and they go to Eastern theology or what New Age theology or whatever ism they can think of. You don't need to look anywhere else. But right here in God's word, this is it. The inherent word of God tells you the truth every time. It will not let you down from the first page to the last page. It is all truth. But people want to look elsewhere. Because I know I did. I look for peace everywhere I can find it. Most of the time for me, it was at the bottom of a bottle. But I found no peace there. Only found peace when I hit my knees and my face on the ground and ask God to forgive me. That's the only time. That's the first time I found peace. And it's every time that's where I find it. Amen. When Jesus defeated death, he secured peace not only for himself, but for all who would follow him in faith. You know, that faith is a scary word for some people sometimes. To have the faith to step out, to have faith to believe, to have faith to do. Oswald Chambers said this about faith. He says, faith never knows where it is being led, but it loves and knows the one who is leading. Isn't that so true? Sometimes we're called by faith to do things and we have no idea how to get there, what we're doing. But we love the one that's sending us. So peace is only possible by being reconciled to God through Jesus. We can look at Hebrews 1:3. We can look at Colossians 1:17. Because we know this peace, because what does Jesus do? It is his nature to do what? To hold us together. And sometimes, man, my life is a train wreck, but God holds it together. Amen. Some of us, our lives are falling apart right before us. We don't know how we're going to pay our bills. We don't know, you know, how we're going to get the next job. We don't know what's going to happen. You know, 8 months ago, it was the vaccine. Now it's, do we take the vaccine? All these things are going on. But Jesus holds it all together for those that know him and those that know peace. It's important during this time that we understand that the gift of peace just wouldn't be possible without the birth of Jesus. Isn't that what Christmas is all about? It's about peace. But it's not the kind you find in a Christmas card. It's not the kind, you know, you find in a commercial or on a TV show. It's the peace that was given to us that day. He was born in a manger. That's the peace that we know as Christians. See, when Jesus became a man, unlike what some claim that he became man, he gave up his deity. No, he came down as 100% man, 100% God. He chose to be born in the flesh. He chose to live in this sinful world for 33 years. But unlike any other person ever born, he was born and lived without sin so that he could be that perfect, unblemished sacrifice for our sins. And that's who we must put our trust, our faith in. Trusting that his death on the cross put an end to the war between God and me. His sacrifice. See, because of his sacrifice, my hostility towards God has been exchanged for a loving relationship with God through Jesus Christ. If you've never accepted Jesus or you've turned away from Jesus, it's time to come back. If you've turned away, it's time to come back. But if you've never accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you can never have peace. Not the true peace and the real peace that the Bible talks about. See, until you first end your war with God, then you'll be reconciled to him through faith in Jesus. It's my prayer this morning that if you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, that you come to that place today as I did almost 17 years ago. It is eternity altering. And I'm sure there's as many people are in here, there's as many testimonies as how Jesus has changed your life, has given you that peace. Even in times of just total chaos around you, God gives you peace, and that can only be found through him. But those of you who know peace, so what do we do for those of you that know peace? We stay connected to Jesus. 1 Colossians 1:23 says, if indeed you continue in the faith, firmly established and steadfast, and not moved away from the hope of the gospel. Now, some people see if, and they think, well, hold on. So you're saying I could lose my salvation? No, that's not what the scripture is talking about. It says, if indeed you continue in the faith, Paul is writing with the understanding that you are going to continue in the faith. He's not questioning it. He's saying, if you know, you continue in the faith. And by you continuing in the faith, you know, that you will be firmly established and steadfast. So the Greek scholar translated like this. He says, assuming indeed that you are adhering to your faith, Paul is not suggesting that you could lose your salvation. He is saying that the way to continue to enjoy peace is to stay connected to the one who has allowed you to be at peace with God. We do that through his word. We do that through prayer. And sometimes we do that by being pruned. See, because when we're pruned, it's for our benefit. Because we also need to do what? We need to keep short accounts with God. Just like we need to keep short accounts with our spouses, especially husbands, We need to keep short account with God. 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and righteous to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. While my overall peace with God is not dependent on works, the fact is that every time I sin, it creates some degree of separation with God. And that needs to be addressed. Because if you sin and then you don't repent, then we get comfortable in our sin, don't we? And then we sin again. Then we sin again. And that chasm just gets wider and wider and wider. That's why I encourage people to come to church, either physically here or online. Because the further you are away from brothers and sisters in the Lord, the further you're away from learning God's word, the further you're away from hearing God's word, that chasm gets wider and wider and wider. And it becomes comfortable to what? Not come to church. It becomes comfortable to do what you want to do. It becomes comfortable to live in your sin. You're all right with it. And it becomes just that thing that you travel with. That's why we need to keep short accounts, and we need to confess our sins when we do it. And, you know, what's part of the pruning process that Jesus talks about in John 15:2, he says, every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch that bears fruit, he prunes it so that it may bear more fruit. See, God will reveal our sin to us. And sometimes we don't like that sin, and so we look the other way. But that we must confess it. That is how we make sure that we do not let that separation come between us and God. You see, when Jesus was born into this world over 2,000 years ago, that was much more than a symbol. Pastor Joe talked about it last week, where it says you are a visible and invisible image. That image is icon, right? It comes from the Greek word icon, where we get our word icon from, right? Where we look to things or look to objects, right? Like when you think of my wedding ring, right? This does not make me married. My wife and I are one. That's what makes me married. The love that I have for her and the love she has for me, this is just a symbol. See, the peace that Jesus gave us, and Jesus is more than the peace. He is peace. And he is the peace that we are given when we accept him as our Lord and Savior. He is the Prince of Peace. He is our peace. He is worthy of our worship. He is worthy of our honor. He is worthy of our praise to him, because he is Lord. If we go back to that verse we first looked at, it says, to whom he is well pleased in Luke. But unfortunately, although the gift is available to all, sadly, many will not receive this gift of peace because they want to do what they want to do. They want to live the way they want to live. I'll have plenty of time, right? I'll have plenty of time to get right with God. We don't know our days. And so why play that game? Why gamble with eternity? I'd ask the band to come up. It's important today that you understand that to know the peace that the Bible talks about is to know Jesus. Because that's the only way to heaven, and that's the only way to be reconciled. For those of you who are sitting here wondering, do you have a relationship? For those that are sitting here wondering, I don't know that peace that that I'm talking about. That's because you don't know Jesus. Understand this, I'll do this. John MacArthur said it this way in his book, The Gospel According to Jesus. This is what John MacArthur said. He said, the biblical mandate for both sinners and saints is not to make Christ Lord, but rather to bow to his lordship. He is ever and always Lord. Whether you make him, like we can do anything, but whether you make him Lord over your life or not doesn't matter. Because at a certain time that God has already put forth, we will all bow to his lordship. He is, and continuing the quote here, he is ever and always Lord, whether or not anyone acknowledges his lordship or surrenders to his authority. God being God doesn't need you to write it off. You don't need to co-sign on that. Just because you don't agree with it doesn't make it not right. It is right. It is truth. God is God. You are not. And the only way to heaven is through Jesus. But some of y'all don't get it. I know I didn't. For 30-some years, I didn't get it. I tried to do it my own way. For those who have never surrendered yourself to Jesus, by receiving him into your life as Lord and Savior, you are still alienated. You are still hostile to God. You are an enemy to God. Your behavior is evil, worthless. Now is the time to accept this free gift of salvation. Receive forgiveness of sins, of your sins, to be justified, to be presented without blemish. Maybe you have mistakenly thought that you could just add Jesus here and there. You're not preparing a dish. You can't just sprinkle Jesus and hope that it goes away. It's all or nothing. It's time to completely surrender to him. Philippians 2, 10 and 11 says this, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow. Of those that are who are in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and that every tongue will confess that Jesus is Lord. Amen. To the glory of God the Father. I'd ask that you stand now. Ladies and gentlemen, if you're here, if you're online, God's word is truth. And we will all bow. We will all confess. But it's where, when. Confessing him into hell doesn't change where you're going to be. It's too late. I'd ask that you bow your heads and close your eyes and let's pray. As the band plays, I'm going to give you an opportunity to come to the altar, come to me and pray. But let's pray now. Father God, I come to you, Father. We come to you, Father. Father, I thank you for your grace and your mercy, Father. I thank you, Father, that you came down, Father, as 100% man, 100% God, Father. Lived this life, Father, and died, Father. Was a sacrifice for me, Father. That you loved me that much, Father. That you knew that I would need a Savior. You went through the pain, the anguish, the separation, Father. For me, so that I wouldn't be separated, Father. So that one day I could spend eternity in heaven, Father. Father, I pray that those that don't know you, Father, I pray that today be that day, Father. I pray that they stop living a life, Father, separated from you, Father. In opposition to you, Father. I pray, Father, today, Father, for those that have walked away, Father, they come back to you, Father. Father, because you are ready for them. Father, you have been waiting for them, Father. And as you wait, Father, I pray, Father, they come to a place where they are on their knees asking for forgiveness, Father. As the band plays, Father, I pray that you search our hearts, Father. And if there's any unconfessed sin, Father, that you give us this opportunity to confess it before you, Father, and ask for forgiveness. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. As the band plays, please come and to the altar to come up to me for prayer.
Blind, but now
height. Just anyone and everyone that's on your mind, you know who they are, but I'd ask that you come up and wear your mask. And as we lift these prayer requests up to the Father, let's go to him now. Father God, we come to you, Father. Father, you are a mighty God, Father. Father, you are Jehovah Rapha, Father. You are the Lord that heals, Father. Father, you are the author, Father, of the book that we read, the Bible that we read, Father. We read about these miracles. We read about the healings that you did, Father, these supernatural healings, Father. You healed the lame man. You healed the blind. And, Father, that's the prayer we're praying for now. That's the miracle we're praying for now, Father. Father, we pray for Eddie. We pray for Jerry. We pray for Raymond, Father. We pray for those that are on our mind right now, Father, for a supernatural healing, Father, that can only come from you, Father. Father, we pray for peace for these men, Father. Father, we pray that you touch them, touch their families right now, Father. Father, we thank you in advance for all that you do, Father. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. May be seated. Well, amen. God is good, amen. And when is he good? All the time. All the time he is good. Wow. Let's praise God, amen. Break it up. Amen. Well, amen. A couple of announcements just to close it out. No evening activities. That means Juarez Lift Youth. This Wednesday's Word will be presented by Pastor Tim. He's going to finish up his series. And so you want to be sure to catch that. Women's Bible study, Sophia is going to come up. I think she's got an announcement to make regarding the women's Bible study starting in January. I didn't bring the handheld to them.
I can.
Sure. Oh, okay. Thank you.
So we'll have Tuesday morning from 10 to 11:30, which will be led by Linda McMillan, and then we'll have Wednesday evening 7 to 8 led by myself. So the Tuesday morning Bible study, they will be starting from the very beginning. So prior to COVID, pre-COVID, we had already started the Seamless Bible study. Tuesday night, they'll be starting from chapter 1. For the Wednesday night service, we'll do a summary of the first couple of weeks, and I think we're going to start out in week 3, and we'll finish that up, and we'll run that because there is a DVD that goes along with it, so we're kind of sharing with that morning group. But I will tell you, I really thoroughly enjoyed Seamless by Angie Smith. She's very, her writing is just everyday language for us. It's not a lot of, you know, digging and researching, but it's very good. It's seeing the Bible from the beginning, from Genesis to Revelation, and the way that she puts it all together has been amazing. So, again, you have two opportunities to join us, either on Tuesday mornings or Wednesday evening.
And I believe Tuesday mornings are recorded, so if you're not able to get live at those times, get with Linda. She can send it to you via email, so you could, wherever you are, if you're at week 1 or week 4, there's an opportunity for you to be a part of it. Don't feel like you have to carve out that time, although if you can, that's great. But if you can't, because of work, and we understand, you can get the recorded Bible study and conversation from those two groups. Amen?
And you can purchase the book either on lifeway.com or Amazon.
No, that's your deal. I don't know. Amen.
Sorry, I'm so
it's okay.
All over the place.
Me too. It's okay.
Thank you.
Amen. All right. Don't forget to stay connected with us online via Facebook, YouTube at brbfchurch.com. Guests and online viewers, it was great to see you and get the opportunity to just minister to you. And if you have any prayer requests, we'd love to pray for you. We consider it an honor to pray with you. If you are a first-time guest online, you can go to our website, bfchurch.com, click on the guest tab, click on and fill out the short survey, submit it, and we'll get in contact with you. If you're here in person, you can fill out the welcome card, drop it in the offer receptacle, and we'll be sure to get in contact with you or reach you via email or phone. Tithes and offering, you know, this is a special worship because, you know, a lot of times we do this, it's just, oh, don't forget your tithes and offerings. But this is an act of worship, amen? And we have all been blessed in more ways than we can count. And the Bible talks specifically about first fruits going to the storehouse. And so continue with your tithes and offerings because it is an act of worship. It is for the church to go out and to love God, love people, and reach the world. And so with that, with the reach the world part, we have our Christmas offering. After all, it is Jesus' birthday. And so if you have that special gift in mind, if you have not done so yet, you could drop it in the offering receptacle just on the offering envelope, put in Christmas gift or Jesus' gift. You could give three ways to give: online, in person, or you could drop it off here at the church. And from my family, from the church family, from the pastors to you, Happy New Year. Be safe. Know we're praying for you. We can't wait to see you in the new year. Hey, it could only go up, right? Amen. Lastly, the food pantry. And I would be remiss in saying this. There are plenty of items in the kitchen. I know they have milk. They have other things. I think milk's in there now, some dairy products. But if you it's close to expire. So if you need milk or dairy products, you can go to the kitchen and take what you need or take what you want. Amen. With that being said, Happy New Year. God bless. See you later. Thank you.